Today we are going to talk about system design, and this I'm going to discuss about how QR code is used in payment transactions. You would have seen a lot of examples like Paytm, PayPal, Google Pay, Amazon Pay, Phone Pay, and similar apps. Let's understand how it is designed for your interview and also if you want to do a real use case on system designs. So here are the key discussion points. So what's QR code? What's the QR payment? Key things to know to understand the system design and QR payment system design in detail, how to use microservices with distributed database and scaling the system. So what's QR code? So QR is quick response code, which is a two-dimensional barcode and it is machine readable. And it consists of an array of black and white squares, typically used for storing URLs or any other text information where you can use a camera and the scanner to read the information. Right? So you're seeing a lot of pictures about the QR code and they are used in a lot of stores at POC terminals, etc. if you want to do any payment transactions. Right? So what's QR code payment? So it's basically a contactless payment. That means you don't involve any physical cash when you are doing a transaction between you and the seller, right? So how does the transaction happens? So let's say you go into the shop, you buy something and you want to pay a cash to the seller. So there is a QR code in front of the shop. What you do is you scan that and you see the amount which you have to enter and you give the amount information and you say yes and the money gets transferred into the seller's wallet, right? That's how it happens. So it is like money transfers from buyer's wallet to the seller's wallet or any account, right? So let's understand what are the key things to know even before you go into detail about the system design. So you should know what is QR code generator. You should know what is a payment gateway, the microservices, load balancers, and even the MySQL database. So what is QR code generator? It is nothing but a software which is a set of APIs where it converts the text into the QR code or where you can convert the QR code into the text. So the most popular I have seen is Zzing, which is done by Google and it is available on the internet to use to see how it can be implemented in your application, right? So what is payment gateway? So payment gateway is nothing but it is a set of software components which helps you to transfer the money from one location to other. Let's say you want to transfer the money from your account to the bank account. So it involves a payment gateway. Let's say in the e-commerce business, let's say you want to transfer money from yourself to the merchant. It goes via payment gateway where the money gets transferred into the merchant account, right? So what are microservices? Microservices are the fine-grained services where you can deploy a test and do what operations whatever you want independently, right? It is comparatively much better than the monolithic service and it can be installed separately, right? So what is load balancers? So we have seen a lot of details about the load balancer in the previous video. Let me give a high level of what load balancers are. So let's say you have tons of requests coming to the server. The server cannot handle on its own, so you have a load balancer in between and it gets all the requests and it transfers or distributes the number of requests to the multiple servers. That means a load gets balanced between the client and the server. That's what load balancer is called. I will also put the description or the details about the other video about the load balancer in the description section so you can go and learn and understand more about that. So what is MySQL database? MySQL is a relational database where you can store the records in the form of the field, right? So you also have a structured query language where you can insert, update, or delete the records, right? So these are the basic use cases which you are going to see in the system design. So you're going to see how to create a QR code, read the QR code, register buyer and seller, transfer money from buyer to seller, and about the database schema used in this system design. If you need more use cases, please comment and subscribe to get in future videos. So what you see on the screen is the database schema which is used in this system design, right? So this is a minimal version of the database and there is a lot of option to improve or increase the number of table if the scope of the application is more. So if you look at the screen, you have two schemas. One is seller schema, the other one is the buyer schema, right? So each has three different tables. So seller schema, if you look into that, you have a seller table which has seller ID, seller name, tax ID, phone, email, account number, bank name, and bank details. And the second table is seller wallet, which has the seller's wallet ID, seller ID, and you have the balance. And the third one is a seller transaction table, so which has ID, buyer ID, purchased item, and amount. So this stores all the transactions when the buyer goes to the seller and buys certain products. Similarly, you have a buyer schema, which has buyer ID, buyer name, phone, email, bank name, and bank details. And there is a buyer wallet where the buyer can store his money, which has wallet ID, buyer ID, and the balance. And the third table is buyer transaction. It has ID, seller ID, buyer ID, purchase item, amount, and status. So this has all the transaction where the buyer is doing with the shopkeeper, right? So you have to understand there is one field which is called status. Let's talk more about the status in the different sections. But this is primarily used when you have a microservice based transactions and or when you have a distributed transaction using a microservices. Let's see more detail in the later section. Okay, before going into the system design, let's understand the sequence of operations. There are multiple ways you can do this operation. So let's go into the type one. In this, what happens is buyer and seller registers in the system. Buyer goes to the store and purchases an item. That information is stored in the buyer transaction table. Seller has transactions stored as well. Seller shows QR code to the buyer generated by the POS device. Buyer scans the QR code through his phone app. Buyer enters the amount and clicks OK. Now the money gets transferred from the buyer to the seller and the receipt generated and the transaction completes. This is a type one which is typically followed when you have a complete software infrastructure. And this is a second sequence of operation, or you can call it as a type two, right? Buyer and seller registers in the system. And the second thing is seller downloads the QR code and displays in front of his store. The seller can also download through the email. So here what happens is buyer goes to the store and purchases an item and the store and whatever the information is stored in the buyer transaction table. Now the buyer scans the QR code displayed in the store through his phone app. Now buyer enters the amount and clicks OK. Money transferred from the buyer to seller. Here the only way of confirmation is SMS notification. That is, SMS notification is sent to the seller and buyer for confirmation. That's how the transaction completes. This is one of the common practice where a lot of street vendors or the cab drivers have, where Paytm is predominantly doing a lot of operations and transactions with this kind of a sequence of operation, right? So what you see on the screen is a very minimal version of system design diagram, which is used to transfer the money from one account to another using the QR code. So let's go a little bit deep into that. So now if you see, there are two sections. One is the seller side and the other one is the buyer side. So you have two apps, seller app and the buyer app. So you can also see the number of services used for both seller as well as the buyer. And you see a database for seller and buyer, which are separate. And there is a payment gateway in the bank, right? So let's go to the services and see what it is for and how it is used. So if you look at the seller app side, you have a service called register seller business, where you go and register the seller information. And those information get stored into the seller table, right? And you have a get QR code for biz. So basically what it does is, it connects to the database and based on all the seller information, it can extract or it can generate the QR code and give us an output. So the seller can print that QR code and can place in front of his POC terminal, or it can place in front of his store so that it can be used for transaction. And the third one is create seller wallet. So if a seller wants to create a wallet, he can use the service to create a wallet, and that wallet information is stored in the database. So the information like, create wallet, whatever the data you collected through the create wallet is stored in the seller wallet, which is the second table. And the fourth one is transfer money from the buyer wallet to the bank. Let's say seller has certain information, or the seller has a certain amount which has to be transferred to the bank. He can use this service where it connects to the payment gateway, and the payment gateway transfer the money to the bank. And if you see here, for get QR code for biz, we are using a Zing API where it can use to convert the text to the QR code. So now let's go into the buyer app. So buyer app interacts with certain services which are over here. So which has a get data from QR code. Let's say you scan your QR code, it gets the text, which is encrypted one, which I have not discussed much over here, but normally it is an encrypted text which you can see in your phone and which can be used for further transaction. And this is a registered buyer. So if you see the first table, whatever information you are giving through the registered buyer can be stored in this table, which is the buyer table. And this is create buyer wallet. So let's say you want to create a wallet. If you are a buyer or if you're a customer, you can use this service to create the buyer wallet. You give informations like phone numbers, email, account number, bank details, and those information gets stored into the buyer wallet database, right? The fourth service you have is transfer money to buyer wallet. So what it happens here is, if you have certain money in the bank, if you want to transfer money from the bank to the wallet, this service is used. What it does is it connects to the payment gateway and in turn connects to the bank, and it transfers money through the payment gateway to the wallet, right? So that is primarily the money is stored into the buyer wallet section or buyer wallet table. So the final service you see on the screen is transfer money from buyer to seller. And it is a very important service, and it is one of the frequently asked question when there is a distributed transaction between multiple schemas and when we are using a microservices. So let's follow the pink line. So when there is a transfer money from buyer to seller, there are certain set of activities which happens, and that's what depicted in the screen. So as soon as this service is called, what it happens is as soon as the service is called, it marks as pending in the buyer schema, right? The status gets changed into pending. Parallelly, what happens is it calls a function called create saga. This function goes into the seller schema and tries to insert the data or tries to insert the money into the seller schema, right? So once it understands if the seller schema has been updated and says it is approved, it comes back over here and it says the pending status is confirmed and the money gets transferred from the buyer schema to the seller schema, right? So let's say in the other case, if it is not able to update in the seller schema and you get a disapproval message, what happens over here is it goes and changes the pending status to cancelled. That's how the whole transaction between the seller schema and the buyer schema works, right? So I have put more details step by step into the screen, and if you want, you can read and understand very clearly. So here I talked about what is a Saga pattern. Saga is a sequence of local transactions where each transaction updates data within a single service, right? So I put the steps how the different sequences of operations are happened. So let's read and understand more clearly. So here we talk about transfer money from buyer to seller, which creates a pending status in the buyer transaction table in the buyer schema, and it creates a function called create saga, right? So create saga sends a command to the seller wallet table to update the wallet amount, which is the sales amount. So create saga at the same time gets message as an update pass or update fail. Let's say if the update passed, then the buyer transaction table in the buyer schema is updated, a wallet table is decremented, and finally pending status is removed. If update failed, then the buyer transaction table in the buyer schema is updated with cancel status. So this is how the whole distributed transaction works, right? So let's talk about scaling of the system. So we can do or apply the scaling in multiple locations, right? So let's say this is a system design. We can apply scaling at multiple locations. The first one is CDN, right? So if a CDN is nothing but a content delivery network. If you have an application and if you have a lot of static content or images or JavaScript, we can directly put it at the CDN, and the client application, instead of going to the server to fetch that every time, it can go to the CDN, which might be the closest location, and it can fetch easily. That's where the CDN comes into the picture. The second one is the Docker and the pods, right? So you have a lot of services. Typically, they are deployed in Tomcat server or WebLogic server, and they are put into the Docker containers, and they are put into the pod, right? So now, if you see the number of requests coming into the service is gradually growing based on the number of months, wherever the application is having, right? So this is going to grow up, right? So what we can do is we can put all the services in the Docker containers, and the Docker containers can be deployed into the pod, and you can have an auto configuration or manual configuration in such a way, right? When number of requests are coming to the services increases, or the CPU goes beyond a threshold limit, let's say 60 to 70%, you can add one more Docker and you can add one more pod, right? So in this way, you know, instead of relying on one machine, you can have multiple containers where it can grow gradually, right? So that you can improve the performance at the app server level. And the third one is the load balancers. So we have talked a detail about the load balancer earlier, right? Let's say if you want to scale the system, you can have a load balancer as well, right? So let's say you have n number of requests coming from the client and hitting the services, right? The services cannot handle all the requests coming to the services, right? So what we can have is, you can have a load balancer, and what it does is it splits the request and gives back to different services. So that, you know, all the requests will not go into one server or one server, and it will be split into multiple servers. In that way, the load gets balanced, right? That's the purpose of load balancer. The last one is the sharding of the database. So you have a database schema over here. Gradually, if you have a lot of buyers or if you have a lot of sellers, it is going to keep growing, and one database cannot withstand. So instead, we'll go a mechanism called sharding. So I'm going to give a detailed video about the sharding in couple of weeks. Keep watching that. I'll give more details on that. And to understand what sharding is, instead of having all the data in one schema, you can split that into multiple schemas, and you can have a lookup to say, let's say customer from A to D, the customer name was starting from A to D wants to hit into the server. You can put those information in one database schema, and the customer from E to W or whatever, right, you can put into the another schema. So in that way, you know, instead of putting all the content in one schema, we can split that schema into multiple schemas, and you can have a lookup where you can identify who the customer and what is his first name, and based on that you can go into the different schema to get those information. So that way, in the load at the database level is also getting split into multiple schema, and gradually you can scale the system. So this is one of the common way which has been used in the industry, right? And if you have any questions, you can put in the comments, so that, you know, I'm very happy to answer. And if you look into this picture, it's a very simplified version, and you can have a lot of services gradually, but just for your understanding and make it simple, I put a minimum number of services to understand the system, right? Thank you very much. Hope you have enjoyed this video. And if you have any comments, put in the comment box. And please make sure you are subscribing, liking, and sharing so that others can also read and understand about this. And you can find me at the LinkedIn. Thank you for watching this video. Have a great day. Bye.